Good morning and welcome to the sixth meeting of 2021 of the Economy and Fair Work Committee. Our first item of business is a decision to take items 4, 5 and 6 in private. Are members content? Thank you. So our main item of business this morning is an evidence session with the Cabinet Secretary on support for economic recovery. It was the Cabinet Secretary's intention to appear here in person, but I understand that's not been possible today. I appreciate that. I thank the Cabinet Secretary and her officials for joining us today, and I welcome Kate Forbes, Cabinet Secretary for Finance and the Economy, Colin Cook, Director of Economic Development, Gary Gillespie, Chief Economist, and Helena Gray, Interim Director of Fair Work, Employability and Skills from the Scottish Government. The purpose of today's evidence session is to consider policies and actions to promote economic recovery. Our evidence today will also inform the committee's input to the Scottish Government's budget for 22-23. I would first of all like to ask invite Colin Beattie, who wishes to make a declaration of interest.
Thank you, Convener. This committee considers tourism as part of its remit. I would direct members to my register of interest, where I'm Vice Chair of the National Mining Museum of Scotland, which of course is a superb tourist destination.
Thank you, Mr. Beattie. I would now like to invite the Cabinet Secretary, Kate Forbes, to make a brief opening statement.
Thank you, Convener, and a very good morning to the committee. Can I apologise at the outset for not being able to join you in person? I can assure you that only COVID would keep me from the committee's scrutiny in person, and I'm sure the committee is quite relieved that I'm not with you in person this morning. I nevertheless welcome the opportunity to give an update on the Scottish Government's plans to deliver economic recovery and also on the 10-year National Strategy for Economic Transformation, which is due to be published in late autumn. I think we are all agreed that Scotland's economy continues to face challenges as a result of the pandemic, and those have been exacerbated by exit from the EU. Economic recovery quite clearly needs to be a joint endeavour, and I look forward to working with the committee and taking on board the committee's suggestions on how we might do that as well as possible. I don't think we can let those current challenges diminish our ambitions for a stronger, more sustainable and more inclusive economy that is pro-prosperity, pro-business and pro-jobs. And our most recent programme for government set out our plans to support recovery by investing in people, investing in places and investing in businesses so that we can grasp the opportunities that lie ahead. That includes more than £1 billion in 2021-22 for our national ambition for jobs and to equip our workforce with the skills for the future. We'll also push forward with a just transition to net zero, supporting innovation and new Scottish industries, and hopefully getting the opportunity to showcase our strengths as Glasgow hosts the COP26 summit. I'm clear that the 10-year National Strategy for Economic Transformation must make the most of the huge potential we have here and in Scotland and align recovery with our ambitions for a well-being economy based on the principles of equality, sustainability, prosperity and resilience, which I'm sure are principles that none of us would disagree with. So that work is continuing at pace. It does lift our eyes beyond the immediate challenges that I recognise many businesses are still confronted with and look ahead to the longer term. The strategy will quite clearly transcend several parliaments, and I hope will deliver the long-term structural change that we need, not only to ensure recovery in the short term, but also to harness our ambitions of delivering a fairer, greener, more progressive future. And because it does transcend multiple parliaments, I'm sure that the committee will have a view reflecting different party political positions. And I look forward to a discussion about that. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. Can I ask a few questions about the 10-year strategy? You say it's expected in autumn. Do you have any more details you can share with the committee about when it's likely to be published? And we have also received some correspondence around consultation. We did receive a letter from Transform Our Economy Group, who held a recent conference, and they have some concerns about the... I understand it was a four-week consultation in the summer. but there is a feeling that they haven't had enough engagement with the strategy. So can I ask, once the strategy is produced, is there any further opportunities for engagement with the strategy, or will it be presented as a done deal, as a strategy that people actually can further comment on?
Thanks, Convener. It's a really important point, and I've been clear that because this is a 10-year strategy, and because we all have an interest in economic recovery, that we had a duty to engage as widely as possible. So firstly, we had the formal consultation, which you've referred to, and Gary Gillespie may want to come in on some of the themes that emerged in that consultation if you're interested in that. But there was a lot of response to that, but it's not the only way that we've been engaging, because we've also been engaging on a one-to-one basis with an extensive list of organisations, businesses, representatives of the third sector. We've had thematic groups which are taking evidence from different parts of society, different parts of our economy. And then running alongside all of that is the Advisory Council, which I hope the committee would accept has quite a broad interest, with representatives from rural and urban Scotland, from big business, small business, economists, as well as industry leaders. So I've certainly tried to make sure that the input to the strategy is as broad as possible. And if any organisation would like to engage further, then certainly I and my officials are very happy to engage. And we are open to taking any written submissions, even if it's not part of the formal consultation, taking written submissions and reflecting on those.
Thank you. Mr. Gillespie, would you have anything to add to that, or about the consultation that was carried out and the way in which people have been involved in the decisions that are getting made? I'm afraid I don't think we have Mr. Gillespie with us at the moment. This is one of the challenges of remote meetings. Oh, no, he. Good morning, Mr. Gillespie. Sorry,
is that
yes,
better now?
Yes, it is, yes.
Sorry, I didn't realise I had the ability to switch my own camera and mic on there, so sorry about that. So as Ms. Forbes says, the consultation ran for approximately 8 weeks. We received around 260 responses from the wider public sector, private sector, third sector, etc. And alongside that, we've been doing extensive engagement, industry leadership groups, enterprise agencies, with our regional partners, local authorities, etc. So really engaging across the piece. The emerging themes that were coming back from the consultation, which we will provide an update to the committee with in due course when we publish the strategy, are around opportunities, net zero, circular economy, around place, how we can strengthen interventions across all of Scotland, around data and digital infrastructure, FDI, jobs, skills, governance, and ideas really about how to transform the economy from energy transition to data, digital and tech. So quite a wide-ranging set of recommendations and ideas coming back from that period. But the consultation continues at the moment, and we're still engaging throughout the period up until the strategy is finalised.
Uh-huh. Could I ask, while there's you described engagement and consultation, how are any tensions that come out of the engagement being resolved? Is that for the government to decide? Because, you know, I mentioned we had a paper from Transform Our Economy who had a recent summit. They have views on how a transition to net zero should take place, but I'd imagine there are different positions within the business sector. Is it the role of government to then reach a consensus on the various positions that are coming forward, and how is that done?
Yeah, maybe I'll respond. Maybe I'll come back on that, and Ms. Forbes might want to come back in. So I think the paper you referred to, I think, was a conference last week, which Ms. Slater participated in behalf of the government in relation to the focus on the National Strategy for Economic Transformation. So I think at the outset, net zero and the transition to that is central to everything we do. So I think, in a sense, that issue of how you resolve tensions is done both through the within government, the Advisory Council, and then ultimately by Cabinet and Parliament when the strategy is published and it's set out. So I think, in a sense, the I suppose you're asking a question, do we know the tensions and is there going to be differences in opinion around some of these issues? And I think that ultimately there will be differences in opinion across different areas, but I think that's for the government and kind of wider engagement to resolve.
Thank you.
And can I come in on that, convener?
Yes, and Ms Forbes, can I add an additional question in, and then I will move on to Fiona Hislop. Yeah. Can I also ask you maybe to comment on the recent Audit Scotland report that raised issues around the difficulty in defining what was current government spend and COVID spend, and trying to track budgets on spending, that it was difficult to distinguish between the funding streams. Could you maybe reflect on that as well as the recent question?
Yes, thanks very much, convener. And just on that question, I mean, the short answer is that's why we have an advisory council. I don't think there is any doubt that there are some difficult choices to be made, and we need only see our inboxes as constituency and regional MSPs to know that there are differences of opinion about what we should do and what we should prioritise. But at the end of the day, I think we've got to base our response on the consultation and also on the debates and deliberations of the advisory council to come to a position and ultimately to make to prioritise for the long term, because what we've seen internationally is that where countries decide on what their agenda is and then stick to it for a longer period of time, they see returns and they see changes. And that's certainly what we would be keen to do. In terms of the financial position, I think that the Audit Scotland report highlights one of the challenges for us. Certainly what we've seen in my role as finance secretary over the last year is the UK government less and less distinguishing between COVID funding and non-COVID funding, for good reason, which is that a lot of our support, actually, it's challenging to distinguish what has become business as usual and what has become specific business support. And I could refer you to the most recent announcement of £25 million for ventilation. In a sense, that is very specifically COVID-related, but quite clearly businesses have had to adapt to what they're doing, and it has become business as usual. So I certainly want to be as fully transparent as possible. The most recent publication of the autumn budget revision updates the budget with the most recent consequential funding, and we will continue to be transparent in terms of the funding coming to us. The one difficulty I would add to this is that this year we don't have a budget guarantee. So last year, when the UK government announced funding, it did so alongside a guarantee that the money would not reduce. And this year, our funding will only be confirmed at the main supplementary estimates, which is usually in February. So until February, we're dealing with estimates. That's not a complaint. It's just a fact that we're dealing with estimates. Those figures can go up or they can go down. And therefore, when it comes to our update to the budget revision, we clearly need to make sure that what we're putting in the budget revision to formally update the budget is based on as much fact as possible rather than on estimates, so that aids the Parliament's scrutiny of our budget position. So I think, just briefly, Audit Scotland is reflecting on what has been a very challenging budget situation, not in terms of the money that we have, but just in terms of keeping track of what the UK government has announced, what is still estimate, and what has been confirmed as fact.
Okay, thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I'll now hand over to Fiona Hislop, who'll be followed by Jamie Hepburn.
Good morning and good to see you all. My first question is to ask what your assessment is of the current economic situation facing Scotland, the immediate pressures, but also what you see over the coming year, and how are you going to reconcile the tension between your 10-year national transformation strategy and a budget which obviously has a short-term pressure that we're facing Scotland immediately. So if I could maybe ask the Cabinet Secretary first, but she may want to bring in Gary Gillespie as well.
Thanks. Lots of very good questions in there. In terms of just a brief reflection on where we are just now, there's two things that I would refer to. One, in terms of GDP and labour market, it's broadly tracked the rest of the UK over the COVID period. So our latest data on GDP shows that Scottish GDP fell by 0.2% in July 2021, but grew 3.4% over the 3 months to July, which means our GDP is 2.4% below its pre-pandemic levels in February 2020. And that broadly tracks the rest of the UK. It broadly reflects where the rest of the UK is. And the same goes for our employment and unemployment. Employment 74.1%, unemployment 4.3%. It would be the rates in May to July 2021. And they continue to compare well with historical trends. I think where I would have more concern right now is in terms of the outlook for businesses when it comes to costs, inflation and labour market shortages. So we know from an inflation perspective that UK inflation rose by 3.2% in the 12 months to August, and the Bank of England forecasts it to temporarily rise further to 4% this year, which is obviously going to have an impact on businesses in particular. But alongside that, it's been well documented in the press that we are facing severe challenges when it comes to energy prices and the knock-on impact that that will have. And alongside that, on labour market shortages, where businesses are struggling to recruit. And that's certainly coming through loud and clear anecdotally from businesses operating in multiple different sectors. So from financial services all the way through to tourism, where there's a reliance perhaps on not just HGV drivers, but on all skills, including in care homes. And that is quite clearly going to add costs to businesses who are already perhaps struggling to keep their head above water post-pandemic. So that would be my very brief summary of the situation. In terms of the budget, I think Fiona Hyslop highlights a really critical point, which is that for the last few years, we've only been able to budget from year to year because there hasn't been a spending review at a UK government level. We were promised one last autumn, but for understandable reasons, that's been delayed. And I'm very hopeful that the spending review published by the UK government alongside its budget will give us that multi-year outlook, which allows us then to plan on a multi-year basis. Clearly, it still won't allow us to plan on a budget, our budget, on a 10-year basis, but it will at least give us a 3 to 4 year outlook, which is of benefit to local government. It's a benefit to businesses because they get then that multi-year certainty. I don't know if you want Gary to come in, I'll leave it to you, convener, to draw in anybody else on the outlook for the economy.
Mr. Gillespie, would you wish to comment on this question?
Yes, I'll just add a couple of brief comments to what the Cabinet Secretary said. So in terms of output in the labour market, in a stronger position than what was forecast even in January, and the output side of things, even the Fiscal Commissioner suggesting output will return to pre-pandemic levels early next year. The Bank of England for the UK are suggesting that could happen at the end of this year. So that's a much stronger recovery than was envisaged, and just reflects the fact that both as things opened up, there was a return to confidence in face-to-face services, people responded. I think in the labour market, obviously furlough comes to an end later this week. Our data suggests just over 3% of private sector employees still on furlough in Scotland in September, but actually the evidence from HMRC and others is around over 90% of people leaving furlough are going back into employment. And as Ms Forbes said, what we're seeing actually is a rising number of job vacancies, actually of an order of magnitude close to the levels of unemployment. So there's a kind of mismatch in the labour market at the minute. And that reflects wider factors essentially relating to the kind of loss of EU labour, the number of workers in the economy being down over the year. So the position's much changed, and actually we are the immediate challenges for businesses relate to the points Ms Forbes made around input costs, supply chain issues around being able to get the right supplies on time to meet orders and demand. So it's a different set of circumstances at the moment. I suppose one final thing in the context of maybe the 10-year National Strategy for Economic Change. We've obviously, the recovery from COVID and the impact that COVID's had over the last 18 months or so on the back of EU exit, on the back of kind of changes to how people live and work. So there's a lot of change within the economy at the moment, and I think that's been played out to multiple impacts at this time.
Thank you. And my other question was really about the issue of pressures on business and what they're telling you they'll need in terms of support over the, particularly of the coming year. Clearly, energy wholesale prices, but other pressures, as we've heard, are going to have an impact on their capability to be successful. So particularly bearing in mind the employment pressures we've just heard about, it's actually a case of reskilling, upskilling, etc. So your perspective, Cabinet Secretary, on the employability support, particularly in the skills area, might be the short-term aspect as opposed to necessarily some of the other business requests we've had in recent years because of COVID and Brexit and other issues. So your comments on that would be helpful.
Thanks. I think this is probably the most important area of intervention right now, because I've already talked about labour market shortages. But in terms of job vacancies, latest figures for the week to the 17th of September show online job vacancies are 33% higher than they were in February 2020. So there is a lot of vacancies out there, and it's ensuring that we line up those that are looking for work with the job vacancies that are available. However, having said that, and to do that, one of the most important, well, two of the most important interventions we have, which you, Fiona, will know better than I do, are around National Transition Training Fund, because you're the one with the vision to establish these things, the National Transition Training Fund, and the Youth Guarantee. So ensuring that young people in particular are lined up with work, and there's certainly no shortage of work, but it's ensuring that they have the skills which they can acquire through the National Transition Training Fund or through the Young People's Guarantee to make sure that they are into work. But I do have quite a stark comment to make, which is that even if everybody who is currently looking for work is in work, there would still be shortages. And the bottom line is, and you're seeing the UK government finally coming to a position of accepting that, that the bottom line is that as an economy, we have valued enormously people who have come to this country to work. And what we are seeing is that those people who might have considered coming here to work are no longer doing so. That might be because of high visa costs. It might be because they no longer feel welcome. There are all sorts of reasons why people are no longer coming to this country to work. And at the end of the day, whilst the Scottish Government can go out and say that they are welcome, that we really need them, that emigration has been the biggest problem in Scotland, not immigration, and that we value people who choose to make their home here, we do not control the immigration policy. And a number of businesses have come to me, and I'm sure they're coming to you as well, to ask for help and support on things like waiving visa costs, which is not within the Scottish Government's control. Or they've asked for schemes which replicate the soft fruit pickers schemes in terms of allowing whether it's HGV drivers or others to come into this country. And we do not have that those levers. So in direct answer to your question, I think there are two means of resolving this and supporting business. One is on the skilling agenda, which I've touched on. But the second, at the end of the day, is that for a country of 5 million people, we really value the contribution made by those that have chosen to come to this country.
Thank you.
Thank you. Can I first apologise to Jamie Halkwell-Johnson for changing his name and his political allegiance earlier? And I'll now ask Jamie Halkwell-Johnson to be followed by Colin Smith.
I think it's Jamie Hepburn you should probably be apologising to. But thank you very much, Convener. Good morning to the Cabinet Secretary and the committee. Just on the points that have just been made there, actually, and something that the Cabinet Secretary said, looking at the supply chain issues, and that's something that's been discussed at this committee, and obviously looking at some of the issues kind of coming up, can I ask, around energy and the like, can I ask, does that mean looking towards the 2022-2023 budget, there may be more of a focus on building resilience into our economy? We've talked about some of the perhaps opportunities even from the issues we're finding, actually doing more local sourcing, using procurement to do that. So will there be more of a focus on building in resilience, innovation, that kind of thing?
I think it's a really good question from the member, and it's something that I'm taking an active interest in. Around procurement, you'll be familiar with some of the limits on our procurement rules under procurement law around things like local content, but it is an area that I'm taking an active interest in. And I probably, I would value the committee's views on how we might use procurement better to embed local resilience around things like local content, because there are some limits on what we can do under procurement law. But if I take a step back from procurement and look at the wider point, I would agree that if our country has learned anything from the last 2 years, it's just how A, resilient our businesses already are, but B, how important it is to build on those strengths and ensure that we are more resilient. As you can imagine, writing a 10-year strategy is hugely challenging because you do not know what challenges might be around the corner. We certainly did not foresee the pandemic, and I don't think some of the challenges that we're currently facing were seen by the UK government. So building in that sense of resilience is important. But at the end of the day, I also recognise that we are exposed to forces outwith the Scottish government's control. And I've already referenced the point around labour shortages, that I think urgent action needs to be taken, because this problem could be resolved with a fair degree of ease if steps were taken around visas, around immigration policy. And I think the UK government has accepted that with its most recent announcement around HGV drivers. The question is whether that's too little too late, and whether that should have been done more quickly.
Thanks very much. I mean, obviously, there are a number of areas where the Scottish Government doesn't have responsibility, but there will be areas that there can be kind of improvements within the power of this Parliament. So hopefully that there will be a focus on that. Just in terms of the Economic Development Agencies and Visit Scotland, there has been a huge focus for them on supporting businesses through the pandemic. And as has rightly been pointed out, there will need to be a continued support going forward of some existing businesses and sectors. So can I ask, in terms of current budget and anticipated budget for 2022-2023, where you think the focus will be in terms of supporting existing businesses and also, while also still providing support for those new businesses, new entrepreneurs going forward, which would be so important for economic recovery? And are you confident that they'll have the support, the budget there to do that?
Well, all of those things will be considered very carefully in the run-up to the budget and on publication. Those enterprise agencies, and you also talked about Visit Scotland, and there are a number of other public bodies that I think have a really important role to play when it comes to economic development. They do need support. They need the right support as well, because often the best support that they can provide is actually the wraparound guidance advice. If you think of a business that is trying to get into an export market, then Scottish Enterprise and SDI have the skills and the resources to help that business. And it is often the fact that they need guidance and advice more than financial support, although we do need to make sure that financial support is available. And you talked about resilience, so developing supply chains, ensuring that they're dealing with mitigating either people and skills shortages, and will all be important. And this year we've obviously invested a combined £347.8 million in our enterprise agencies, which was an uplift of almost 17%, and that reflects the need to support businesses. One of the challenges we will face in next year's budget, though, is that some of that support that we've previously given to enterprise agencies was in the form of financial transactions, which often allowed enterprise agencies to provide the right kind of support to businesses that weren't looking for grants necessarily, but were looking for short-term financial support. And we have seen a significant reduction in FTs. The UK government is moving away from providing FTs because of changes to its own housing supply programme. So that means that our spending power, as it were, will decrease because of the reduction in FTs. And I think we'll need to look at other ways of providing funding out of a very challenging budget.
Okay. Just one last very quick question. The committee, the Economy Committee legacy report from the last session, which I was on the committee but not involved in that report, talked about how difficult it was to actually measure outcomes from some of the development agencies, particularly. And I was wondering whether there'd been any work done to improve our ability to work out basically what the bang for the buck is in terms of investment in our development agencies.
Thanks. It's an issue that I have raised in conversation and discussion with all of the enterprise agencies since I first took post around measuring outcome. And they certainly have metrics, which I can share with the committee, that they will publish publicly on measuring their impact. Clearly, some of that performance is quite difficult to measure because in terms of businesses, often we look to how many jobs have been created, for example, where that might not be the best metric for a small business that's just starting out. But I think we need to be really careful with what metrics we apply on a blanket basis, because it may actually distort what businesses are trying to do to be successful. And this was a point that was brought out through Mark Logan's report on developing the tech industry, where he criticised the fact that we often look at job creation as a measure of success, not realising that for a small entrepreneur, maybe the worst thing you could be doing at the outset is trying to create multiple jobs instead of delivering growth first and then creating the jobs. So I'd be happy to share anything further with the committee after this conversation, and certainly share what.
Cabinet Secretary, we just missed the very end of that final sentence. But I think you were just offering to share further information with us regarding Scottish Enterprise. And
yeah, that's right. I can share what enterprise agencies already use in terms of metrics.
That's great. Thank you. I now pass over to Colin Smith, followed by Michelle Thompson.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the panel. Can I continue on the issue of the role of the agencies? The Cabinet Secretary just said that there's a lot of agencies who provide support, and it's obviously 5 years since the Skills and Enterprise Review. And one of the issues that constantly still comes up a lot from business, and in fact in evidence to this committee, is the extent to which the business support landscape is still very cluttered. In fact, the FSB told the committee the system is too complex. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, do you think that the Skills and Enterprise Review and its implementation has done enough to declutter the landscape, to give businesses that one-stop shop approach? And if not, how will this be dealt with in the forthcoming economic strategy?
Thanks very much. And clearly the Enterprise and Skills Strategic Board has made a very strong start in trying to streamline what is available. I think COVID has complicated that quite substantially, considering the number of new schemes and initiatives that were announced over the COVID period. And the challenge in government, and I think the challenge too for opposition, for both of us, is to identify what needs to stop when something new starts. So it's easy to call for new things and it's easy to announce and implement new things. Much more difficult to stop things because you know that it will never be met with support or with a commendation. But I think that the challenge after COVID is actually to reflect on what has become perhaps even more complex for businesses to navigate and to streamline that. Now, some of those COVID supports have come on stream and then been turned off because they were no longer needed, but others are still available. And I think there is an action there for government working with the Enterprise and Skills Strategic Board to try and streamline further, taking into account the complications that COVID has added.
I think the message really from business isn't as much the number of different schemes, it's actually having that one-stop shop of places to go. So no matter how many agencies are behind a single portal, businesses just want to go to one place to get that information on a regular basis, and it clearly comes up a lot. What also comes up is the issue around awareness. FSB told the committee that their members felt that the main economic agency, Scottish Enterprise, was not visible enough during the pandemic. In fact, the quote they gave us was, we were in the middle of a crisis, Scottish Enterprise was not there. Mm-hmm. Do you think that's a fair reflection, and why do you think they're saying that?
Well, obviously, at the outset, we had to mobilise support very quickly. And we mobilised support largely through local government. And local government have been a phenomenal partner when it comes to support, because they've distributed financial support in ways that they never had done before. So I think there is a fair point in reflecting on the fact that local government ended up being our primary partner when it came to delivering support. I think there's good reason for that, because at the end of the day, they know their local economies better than anybody else. And they were able to reach businesses that perhaps weren't on the radar of either the national or the regional enterprise agencies. But at the same time, Scottish Enterprise was absolutely critical in mobilising other forms of support. They were absolutely critical in using their personal relationships with key businesses, particularly key anchor businesses, which often play a big role in protecting local economies. And so I think they did play a critical role, even if they weren't playing local government's role of distributing support on the front line. But I wonder if Colin Cook wants to come in on any of that. Colin Cook manages our relationship with the enterprise agencies.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Yes, I mean, just to add to that, I think we very much recognise the charge that the landscape of business support remains cluttered. I think the agencies themselves accept that. And although they have made some really good progress in terms of joint working since the original skills review, I think they've made some really good progress in terms of the way in which they present their information through an amalgamated website, for example. All of them recognise that there is more to do. And within the context of the 10-year economic strategy, the Cabinet Secretary has been very clear to me, and should be very clear to the enterprise agencies, that the key issue is going to be how we deliver this. And that means that we need to redesign the support that we offer businesses from the perspective of the business itself, and to really put ourselves into their shoes and to understand how they would like support delivered. And that will have implications for the way in which our agencies work and the way in which they work together. I think we've learned a lot during COVID. I think there's been a lot more direct engagement from the Scottish Government, for example, and we were talking about some of that earlier. But each of the enterprise agencies and Visit Scotland have shown up, and they have done some extremely strong things. I think what it has proved more than anything else is that the economic development landscape is an ecosystem, to coin a popular phrase. It includes public sector organisations, it includes government, it includes private sector organisation. And the challenge that we have is to make sure that we create and leverage that system as a whole over the next few years to provide our companies and our entrepreneurs with the support they need.
Thanks very much for that. Obviously, a key part of this is making businesses aware of what's actually out there, not necessarily there are a range of agencies. Small businesses is simply getting on with the day job. They've got their head down. They don't know what's available. So what are the Scottish Government, listening to what you've said and learning from the pandemic, what changes do the Scottish Government plan to make to raise awareness of what is available to businesses out there, and in particular about equality of awareness? Because one of the issues that was raised with us is breaking down the barriers to businesses led by women in particular. So what are we doing to raise that whole issue about equality of awareness of what business support is actually out there?
Cabinet Secretary, would you like...
Thanks. Three things immediately spring to mind. And Colin Smith, I don't in any way dispute your characterisation of the need to do this. So just to make that clear, and I think doubly so after COVID. I think firstly, that small businesses do not care who's behind the portal, but it needs one portal that you know you can go to and get help. And it's our business in the public sector to ensure that they get the right help. But if they put in the question, they are going to be guided to the right people. And that's so the portal is important. Now, we trialled the Find Business Support portal, which you'll probably be familiar with, over the pandemic. And I think it needs to be something like that. Secondly, though, is making sure that the support is as local and as regional as possible. You will know, and I know, how successful the South of Scotland Enterprise Agency has been and Highlands and Islands Enterprise Agency is when it comes to the localised regional support. But there are other areas where the support is not as localised and as regionalised. And it was a conversation I had yesterday with Scottish Enterprise, which is how do you break down so that individuals know precisely who to go to in their local area for support from SE, if it's not HIE and South of Scotland, it would be the second thing. And then the third thing that we need to do is rationalise on all the pots of funding that is available. I think the Enterprise and Skills Board was trying to count up all the number of different pots. And I would really like to see that all condensed into one. So if you need support for anything related to, for example, export markets, you know where to go. If you're trying to get help for digital, you know where to go, and you're not trying to weigh up 5 or 10 different pots for digital, you know there is one place to go. So those would be my three suggestions for things that need to be done, and we will certainly actively move to implementing that. I think it needs to go alongside the national strategy, though, so that our delivery is as simplified as our aims and objectives.
Thank you. I'll move over to Michelle Thompson.
Good morning, Cabinet Secretary and everyone else. the situation around FTEs has already been mentioned earlier, and I think it's clear the concern that's been expressed with the changes in funding. But I just wanted to allow you to put on the record around any mitigations and how you plan to approach, given the Scottish Government's undoubted focus on supporting business and growing the economy. So it's just if you can give any further insights on how you're going to manage to mitigate the loss of FTEs going forward. That's for yourself.
It's difficult. I recorded my concern this time last year in advance of the budget because the UK spending review last year in 2020 only gave financial transactions budget for this coming year. So it means it's difficult to publish before, beyond that, so to plan beyond that. But the budget gave us a 66% reduction in FTEs, which we've had to manage through quite rigorous prioritisation. And you will have seen the consequential headlines on that, where we haven't been able to fund things with a very limited pool of FTs. The majority of FT consequentials, it might be helpful to say, used to come from the UK government's Help to Buy schemes. Those are expected to continue into next year, so they may continue to mean that we get consequentials from the FTs, but that will not be confirmed until the 27th of October this year, the UK government's budget. So that's quite a reduction in 1 year. 66% is quite a substantial reduction to manage in 1 year. And our FTs have previously been used to fund the Scottish National Investment Bank, our housing programme, as well as some of the financial support provided through our enterprise agencies. So it was tough to manage that substantial decline in 1 year. And we await to see what the UK government might do around FTs in their budget on the 27th of October.
Okay, thank you. And just following on from that then, in terms of, I mean, given the focus that's been around supporting capital investment for early stage businesses, how is the kind of progress in terms of managing with that with Scottish Enterprise and into the investment bank and so on? Where's that at the moment, if you could give some insights?
So it remains one of our priorities, and I think without pre-announcing the strategy, the 10-year strategy, it's going to be a substantial focus for the strategy, which is Scotland as an entrepreneurial nation. How do you ensure that there is the right kind of support for anybody in Scotland to start and to scale up a business so that in Scotland we have a lot of our economic growth coming from new and emerging businesses. So it will be, if it's a focus in the A in the 10-year economic strategy, it will be a focus for Scottish enterprise. And Scottish enterprise continue to provide that support. Clearly, there is an infrastructure that has built up, though, over the last few years from the private sector to support early businesses too. So where you've got Edge, you've got Tom Hunter's Foundation providing support to try and help early businesses, young companies start. I think just running alongside that, Scottish National Investment Bank does have a role to play, and hopefully it's an expanding role to play in some of these early businesses, because I see SNIB's responsibility as being providing patient capital where it's too risky for the private sector. And we have an obligation in the public sector to take on board some of that risk that the private sector won't go near. Now, that's a difficult conversation in Parliament, where what do we think of risk? What does the opposition, how does the opposition deem risk where it may lead to a loss of public sector funding, but it may also lead to some of the most successful businesses we've ever seen? And is the public sector willing to take that risk? And does Parliament think that it's right that the public sector should take that risk?
Okay, thank you, Camilla.
Okay, thank you. Can I just ask a couple of questions about the financial transactions on the back of Michelle Thompson's questions? The Cabinet Secretary will know that Scottish Enterprise set out to the committee that they are facing a funding gap because of the consequences of a drop in financial transactions returns. And also, if you can address the issue of the Scottish National Investment Bank, where the assumption was that financial transactions is what would provide the sources of capital for SNIB. So is the position on financial transactions to wait and see what the UK government are going to decide? Or is there an alternative plan being put in place for SNIB, who on the forecast that was originally done, you know, it is challenging if the financial transactions continue to be reduced?
Thanks. I think there is a big question at this year's budget in terms of FTs. Now, I already said that the UK government appears committed to continue the Help to Buy scheme, so that gives us an element of reassurance around FTs continuing to some degree. And we're also anticipating the UK government publishing its multi-year spending review on the 27th of October. So that will give us a sense of what will come over the next 3 to 4 years. But this year, we prioritised the Scottish National Investment Bank. The two priorities for our funding were business support, so primarily through Scottish National Investment Bank, but also with some support for Scottish Enterprise and our housing programme. So in short, if you don't fund a housing programme or SNIB through FTs, then you've got to do it through capital. And capital is also in short supply, largely because we also can't borrow substantial capital. So capital is, I'd much rather use FTs. But I think the short answer is that we will continue to prioritise FTs for the Scottish National Investment Bank, and our commitment to capitalising the Scottish £1 billion, it remains undiminished. How I do that is, as it were, a headache for me in collaboration with the UK government. But that commitment to ensure that Scottish National Investment Bank has the funding it needs is undiminished. And I hope that this year's budget proves that commitment, where we have been unwavering in ensuring that the Scottish National Investment Bank has the support it needs to do its job.
Okay, thank you. Maggie Chapman.
Thanks very much, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Thank you and the rest of the panel for being here this morning. Cabinet Secretary, you spoke earlier about some of the challenges using metrics like number of jobs created to track success of the economy, or to as a criterion for eligibility for financial support. And you also spoke of some of the constraints in our ability to build resilience because of restrictions around procurement law and that kind of thing. Can I ask, thinking about the programme for government's commitment around conditionality, to drive the changes we need to see in net zero, fair work and well-being, what are the barriers, do you think, to ensuring the pace of change in these areas is fast enough? And are we doing enough to ensure that we actually get the outcomes that we hope conditionality will deliver?
Yes, and the member refers to our commitment to strengthen conditionality further. There are specific targets. So, for example, by summer 2022, we have committed to introduce a requirement on public sector grant recipients to pay at least the living wage to all employees and to provide appropriate channels for effective workers' voice, like trade union recognition. So that would be an example. So I think that we need to strengthen our commitment to conditionality through engagement with unions, with businesses, with other stakeholders, to consider how to, its effectiveness, I think, relies on its proportionality and in ensuring that we can measure real benefits for it. There's a real danger when you associate conditionality with outcomes that businesses actually can't deliver. So for example, if you were to say, and I know this is not what you're suggesting, but if you were to say that you can only get a grant if you commit to creating, you know, 10 new jobs in your first year, well, it may be the wrong metric for the business, and it's probably going to lead to an unsuccessful outcome. Paying the real living wage, I think, should be a given. You know, it should be almost like a non-starter. It should be a basic expectation. And you'll have seen it quite recently in the discussions around green ports or free ports, where that has proven really difficult to deliver in collaboration with the UK government, where there was we could not come to a compromise on the notion that businesses should be paying at least a real living wage. And that meant that we have taken our own approach and the UK government will do its thing. So in short, I think we have a number of levers to try and deliver that. And conditionality is a key part of trying to ensure that we embed fair work across the country.
Okay, can I just follow that up? Thanks for that answer. I hear your commitment to consult and to engage with trade unions. Can you say just a little bit more about that? Because there's a commitment to consult on applying conditionality to public funding, consulting businesses, including discussions around requirements for public disclosure on climate change and its impacts. Can I ask just about the work that's actually ongoing with workers and trade unions, because I think sometimes they are maybe not better able, but they are closer to understanding those levers that we need to have access to and we need to be using.
Yeah, so I personally engage with the trade unions on this very topic. Richard Lochhead leads on the work, and he obviously has regular dialogue with the Fair Work Convention and I should say that all of this sort of that Fair Work First approach is because we don't have employment powers, so we have to think of different ways of doing that, and that means a lot more sort of softer approaches. But yes, we are intending to launch a consultation in the coming weeks on what a leading Fair Work Nation would look like, to align with the aims of a just transition to a well-being economy. And that consultation, which will invite responses from anybody who chooses to respond, so it is a very wide consultation, will inform a review of our existing Fair Work priorities, particularly in the context of COVID's impact on the labour market. So there's a formal consultation, but there is also simultaneously extensive engagement on a one-to-one basis with trade unions, which I and Richard Lochhead and indeed the First Minister are all active participants in.
Okay, thank you. Gordon MacDonald, to be followed by Colin Beattie.
Thank you very much, convener, and good morning, panel. I wanted to ask about tourism. Cabinet Secretary, we're aware that tourism is important for the Scottish economy, and it's been hit hard by the lack of international visitors. Earlier this year, it was announced that a new £25 million tourism recovery programme was being launched. Can you see how that funding was utilised to support Scottish tourism?
Thanks. Yes, I can. So you're right in saying that it was a direct response to the tourism task force, which had a lot of industry leaders represented on it. That £25 million is phase one of the tourism recovery programme, and it provided support, for example, for reskilling and retraining. It also provided support for marketing campaigns to try and increase footfall. So there was a number of different elements to it, recognising that the tourism and hospitality businesses more widely had been particularly hard hit. Alongside that, quite clearly, one of the biggest challenges that they have faced in recent months is the labour shortages. They were perhaps one of the first industries to be hit by it. And we, in conjunction with them, launched a recruitment campaign that ran over the summer months from the 5th of July to the 18th of August, with financial support from the Scottish Government to try and bring more people into the industry. So there were a number of different elements to that. But we have also been working alongside the tourism task force to look at what phase two of the support would be. So we've implemented phase one with £25 million, but we are working with them to consider what phase two would look like.
Are you able to say anything about phase two in relation to how we have a sustainable recovery in the medium to long term?
Yeah, I'm happy to bring in Colin Cook, because he does a lot of work in this space. There has been a submission of various recovery proposals. We are looking at the best way of supporting phase two over the next 2 years. It is a bit of a longer term approach. So phase one was sort of the immediate challenges, but phase two will look more broadly. But Colin Cook, do you want to speak more to that?
Yes, I'd love to, Cabinet Secretary. And yes, I mean, work is going on between my team, Visit Scotland, and various representatives of the tourist industry through the Scottish Tourism Emergency Recovery Group to shape those phase two proposals. And whilst we're not yet in a position to commit to what they are going to be or the amount of financial support that they can be given, we're clearly looking to build on much of what was achieved in the first stage. I mean, international demand building, putting Scotland back on the sort of international tourist map is a long-term exercise. Supporting strategic tourism infrastructure development is a long-term exercise. So there are a number of things, certainly addressing those questions about how you apply digital technology to the tourism industry and how you train and encourage people into the industry and convince people that this is a career with all the opportunities that those of us who work in it or work with it know that it has. These are long-term initiatives. So we are working with the tourism sector. We are trying to shape the phase two recovery proposals, and hopefully soon we'll be able to talk more about what they mean with the industry and with yourselves.
And just my final point is, it was estimated that 6.5 million people took staycations in Scotland during the summer, making Scotland the third most popular destination in the UK. How will the government build on that increase in domestic visitors? And in the forthcoming budget, the 22-23 budget, are you able to indicate how you will support the sector, including investment to address infrastructure pinch points?
Thanks. It's worth, I think, celebrating those figures, because we clearly in Scotland have significant strengths when it comes to our tourism and our hospitality offering. And clearly, as the person who represents one of the best bits of Scotland, which saw a lot of visitors over the summer months, I can see how hard businesses have worked after a phenomenally challenging 18 months to be in a position to welcome people. So I do think we need to build on that. I think there are particular pinch points, and we've got a commitment, particularly in rural areas, to invest in infrastructure alongside what we're doing to support the businesses themselves. So the Rural Tourism Infrastructure Fund is one of the most obvious examples of that, where rural areas that were not prepared and geared up to deal with the huge numbers that came have received financial support to put in place parking, toilets, expanding roads, parking places, things like that to relieve congestion. And I think we need to look at what support needs to be perhaps in urban areas as well to deal with some of the challenges of increased numbers, which is good for our economy.
Okay, thanks very much.
Okay, thank you. Colin Beattie.
Thank you, Convener. Cabinet Secretary, this committee has been taking evidence in recent times about the challenges around the supply chain, and we understand that that's a complex area comprising not just domestic supply chains but international supply chains as well. We've also been looking at labour and skill shortages alongside that. But we recognise that there are limits as to what the Scottish Government can do to fix the supply chains. So I would ask you, what policy levers does the Scottish Government actually have in order to alleviate these issues of the supply chain and labour and skill shortages? And how will these be reflected in the upcoming budget?
Thanks. Firstly, short answer is that they will be reflected in the next budget, because these are some of the most pressing issues facing businesses and hampering potentially our economic recovery if we don't resolve it. What levers do we have? Well, if I go through a number of levers, there are financial levers. So where businesses need financial support, or where businesses require to make investment in supply chains, then there are things there that we can consider. But our budget is severely challenged, and quite clearly resolving issues in one area requires budget to be taken from another area. So the financial efforts, I think, are quite limited when it comes to resolving supply chain or labour market shortages. The second thing is, and I've already referenced this, when it comes to labour market, is making sure that the right people have the right skills for the right jobs. And there's a short-term imperative through the National Transition Training Fund to help those who are facing redundancy or who have recently left work to reskill, retrain for new jobs. So there's the short term. There's the longer term, however, which is looking ahead over the next 5 to 10 years, making sure that our higher and further education institutions are set up to be able to deliver those skills for the future. But that's a longer term thing that won't fix the immediate challenge. The next lever we have is around procurement, where we need to, I think, incentivise the use of local supply chains to strengthen local supply chains and mean that we're less dependent on uncertain supply chains elsewhere. But again, that has I think that's got limited benefit, because we can't avoid the fact that our supply chains are exposed to international fluctuations and international challenges as well. The last lever that we have is engagement with the UK government, which is something I take very seriously, and I recognise my responsibility to engage with the Chancellor, with the new Chief Secretary to the Treasury. And as you can imagine, over the last 2 weeks, I have had conversations, correspondence with the Business Secretary on the impact of rising energy costs alongside Michael Matheson, when there was a crisis around a potential challenge around CO2, engaging with the UK government, exchanging data on what's happening in Scotland, and trying to help with the UK government to come to a resolution on those issues. I think the biggest challenge for us right now in engaging with the UK government is trying to put in place solutions to the labour market shortage. These issues have been emerging since probably June and July. I had very early conversations about labour market shortages when it was being raised by tourism and hospitality industries back in June. And so it's been a long time coming, looking for a solution. And the most recent announcement around a visa option for haulage is part of the solution. But I think most people would agree that it's too little too late, and haulage is not the only industry that is struggling with that. And Helena Gray, who's also on the call, is working alongside business to develop a 10-point plan looking at how we respond to these issues and where we have levers. I'm sure she'd be happy to come in if the convener would wish that. I'm also conscious that you perhaps want to keep moving on to other issues.
Mr. Beattie, would you like to hear from Ms.
Kay? I think it would be useful, yes.
Yeah, please do.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. Good morning, Committee. Yes, just to really reiterate what the Cabinet Secretary has said, that we are working very collaboratively with businesses, industry representatives and others to really understand the challenges that they are facing and to develop a shared action plan that focuses on the levers that we do have available to us, but also on where action may be required on levers that that are reserved to others as well.
Cabinet Secretary, you said you were in close contact with the UK government in relation to supply chain in particular. How fruitful have these discussions been? How useful have they been? Is there a result coming out of this that's going to benefit us?
Well, on some areas, we have seen a swift resolution, even if it's a temporary resolution. So last week, there were a number of discussions around the challenges around CO2, which, to give credit where it's due, have been resolved, I believe, on a temporary basis, where there hasn't been a reduction in our CO2 supply. But there are still very live issues around energy costs, which I think will continue to have an impact on prices, on supplies, and on the ability to deliver to customers. And those issues have not been ultimately resolved. I think that we've seen some examples where there's been a swift resolution. These are challenging issues, so I don't want to be overly critical. Where I would be much more critical is on labour market shortages, because labour market shortages are resolvable. They are within the gift of the UK government, and too often it's an ideological position that has prevented a swift resolution than anything else. And I think there was a very emotive comment by a Polish lorry driver, I think, on the radio last week, who said, you know, having felt unwelcome for a number of years, you can't just turn the taps on now and assume that European citizens will come flooding back. Despite that, we are seeing shortages in care homes. We're seeing shortages in hospitality and tourism and in manufacturing bases. Right across the board, we're seeing shortages. And that has been exacerbated by the pandemic. But there's no doubt, and I think everybody's pretty much agreed, that it has been significantly exacerbated by an immigration policy that has reduced the number of EU citizens working in this country.
Is it time for a further question?
If it's brief, you can have a question.
Let me, Cabinet Secretary, just ask a very brief question. If you could update on the measures to mitigate the COVID-19 labour market impact, particularly for young people.
So there are a number. I think particularly on the skills side, obviously, the Young Persons Guarantee is continuing, and led by Sandy Begbie. And we have been working to implement that to ensure that young people have access to jobs and to skilling or retraining. And I think that's one of our primary economic levers in trying to help young people when it comes to the impact of the pandemic.
Okay, thank you very much. Alexander Burnett.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. We've finally got the R100 programme for the North Lot. For constituents to look at, and you know, disappointingly to say initial feedback's not been positive. There are still numbers of errors which occurred on the previous lots, such as people it says they're connected when they're clearly not. Many saying the dates they're being given, 2026, is not particularly satisfactory. And the contributions under the voucher schemes are insufficient, especially when they're being quoted previously. Costs of near 100,000 in some cases for some groups of houses to be connected. This means they're going to be unable to develop businesses, and in some cases are now considering moving away. So can I ask how many will be connected via the North Lot, and what is the review process of this initial rollout that's been announced? And most importantly, where should we be directing constituents with their questions and to point out errors?
Thanks. I should obviously say at the outset that telecommunications has always been a reserved matter. So this is over and above what the UK government will be doing. And the R100 programme is clearly getting this infrastructure into non-commercial areas at a time when the UK government's gigabit programme, which tries to deliver a similar programme to R100, is still at its planning stage. And we are already funding the full extension of full fibre in some of the hardest to reach communities anywhere in the UK. And we are actually trying to work with the UK government to secure a fair share of the £1.2 billion that they've announced through the Project Gigabit to push that coverage even further. So where we can go further, we absolutely will go further. To date, we've had 1,592 connections that have been delivered by the R100 central contract. There are 3,052 currently in build and 1,595 connections to be delivered via the R100 south contract. In terms of the north contract, which was specifically what you referenced, that build work has commenced as part of the R100 north contract. I'd be very happy to provide the member with a breakdown of precisely what is intended through the north lot, through the central lot, and through the south lot, understanding that if we can increase those numbers, we will absolutely increase those numbers. And I am in conversation with Openreach on a regular basis to see how much further we can push those numbers.
Thank you. So still on that question, you did answer the first part and I'm grateful for that in terms of the numbers. But in terms of a review process for that rollout, and most importantly, the R100 being within the Scottish Government's remit, where do we direct constituents' queries and errors?
So on that latter point, obviously just as of, I think, a fortnight ago or so, there is now a provision online, and I'm happy to share the link with the committee for every for the details for the R100 North lot in particular, for households to understand when and how they will be connected. And also, I'm sure that if it hasn't already been shared, there is contact details, because my team regularly inform MSPs of progress. And so I would recommend that you use those contact details that are already being used to inform MSPs of progress for feedback. In terms of a review, though, I'm assuming you mean a review of the overall contract rather than a review of individuals. And in terms of that review, I guess two points to that. One is that it's almost iterative, it's ongoing. I have regular conversations with Openreach. We are continuing to try and push Openreach to go as far as possible. So where there has been public sector spend, where they might be able to go further in terms of commercial links. And I'm also in conversation with the UK government in terms of getting a share of that £1.2 billion. So in that sense, the review is ongoing. We've got a baseline, which is in the contract, but if I can push that further, I absolutely will push that further. And I can assure the member, although it's probably not much consolation, that my constituents are as agitated and as exercised about whether or not they will get broadband as his probably are. So I hear it on a regular basis in surgeries and most recently in the election campaign.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I've no doubt she does hear that, much appreciated. Connected to moving on, sorry, yeah, poor broadband. We've heard this week about poor rural healthcare provision. We've heard previously the shortfall in the spending of the Rural Housing Fund. We have issues with rural public transport issues. Again, I know the Cabinet Secretary is well aware of all these issues given her own constituency. But in the papers today, one of the largest sums mentioned by the Scottish National Investment Bank is the £50 million invested in a forestry fund. And I note my own register of interest regarding forestry, nearly 10 times their next largest investment. And I just wonder how financing fund managers speculating on carbon prices leading to driving up rural land prices, in some cases creating a modern version of the clearances seems counterproductive to supporting rural economies. So my question is, where is the understanding of a rural economy and where is the joined up solutions when we see measures like today, which are, like I say, are counterproductive?
I think it's a really important question, because whether it's looking 10 years down the line at our economic strategy, or whether it's looking next week in terms of some of the businesses that are struggling, if all of Scotland cannot benefit and contribute, then we will not have succeeded. So I strongly dispute the notion that if some of your urban centres are contributing and driving economic growth and your numbers nationally look good, then you've succeeded. I think that is the UK model, which depends on London and the South East to fire the cylinders. And in Scotland, I think we need to do differently. I think also rural areas are often, at the risk of alienating some of the urban MSPs here, rural areas are often the most entrepreneurial. They provide a huge opportunity when it comes to pioneering solutions. You'll have seen that in our commitment around helping some of our islands become carbon neutral before anywhere else. I think there is an opportunity to do that. But that is all rhetoric unless we build the infrastructure, unless we ensure that there is a skills plan. And of course, we do have the skills action plan for rural Scotland. Unless that's in place and the financial support, then we will not achieve that. But I suppose, really briefly, in short, I would say that one, it's important that we're reskilling, upskilling and providing opportunities to communities in rural Scotland. I think the Skills Action Plan does that. Secondly, we are making sure that there are opportunities for rural entrepreneurs. We've got the Rural Entrepreneurial Fund. And then thirdly, that we make sure that we are investing in infrastructure. We have got the infrastructure investment plan over the long term, over the next few decades, which looks at investment in rural hospitals, investment in rural schools, investment in rural roads. And I think altogether that provides an opportunity for rural Scotland. In terms of the point around the Scottish National Investment Bank, the member will know that it's operationally independent from ministers, and therefore those decisions are taken by the bank for very good reason. I think the less political involvement there is in the bank's decisions, the better.
Thank you. No more questions. Thank you, Convener.
Okay, thank you. Jamie Harcourt-Johnson, do you have a supplementary?
I do. Just a very quick question. The Cabinet Secretary, you talked about rural infrastructure, you talked about roads and the like. One of the real issues, as I'm sure you'll be aware, is those from an island community like myself, the lack of investment in some of the, or the need for investment in new ferries across within our island communities, like in the Northern Isles, but also on the West Coast as well. So what kind of hope can you give island communities that in the next budget and looking forward, there's going to be some serious investment in terms of that ferry infrastructure?
So three things. One is that I am absolutely determined that the current two vessels are completed that are currently in construction. Now, I know that there's a lot of discussion around the future of the yard, but if I separate the yard just a moment from the vessels, those vessels have got to be completed. And that is one of the most important issues on my agenda. Secondly, we are making progress on CMAL's procurement of new vessels with the announcement of the most recent two vessels. And that pipeline, therefore, is starting. Beyond that, the third point I would make is that over £500 million has been committed to procuring additional vessels, so particularly around the small vessels procurement programme, to bolster and to boost the fleet. I know how challenging it is right now for island communities. You and I both represent some of those island communities, and again, it's another issue that I see regularly in my inbox. So those would be my three points in terms of the need to resolve the issue and reflecting on the fact that it absolutely and urgently does need to be resolved.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Before we close, can I return to the issue of the Scottish National Investment Bank? The Cabinet Secretary has given a firm commitment this morning to finance SNIP, and you also in the recent response referred to their independence. Can I ask if a target rate of return has been set for the bank by the government? And also the Cabinet Secretary will be aware that a number of bonus incentive payments have been made in the initial months of the bank being established. Previously, the government have said that there would be no annual financial target-based bonuses within the bank, and there would be medium to long-term incentive schemes. Does the Cabinet Secretary, does she have a view on the recent bonuses and payments that have been made in the short lifetime of the bank?
Thanks for that. And just to reiterate that point, I do agree, it does need to be operationally independent. In terms of the two specific questions, as agreed during the passage of the bill, setting an overall target rate of return too soon could risk the target not being met. And I think it's really important that we recognise the bank's role when it comes to long-term capital investments. I am, however, keeping that position under review, and a meaningful target will be agreed or set once there is a sufficient level of activity on which we can report. And clearly, I'd be happy to keep the committee updated on that point. The bank obviously will seek a commercial return on every investment it makes. The actual amount is going to vary depending on the risks and the type of investment. And you've already seen in the last year or so the varying nature of investments that have been made. But the bank is also required to deliver social, economic, environmental returns as well as financial returns in the investments it makes. And I think that needs to be weighed up. In terms of the more specific point around the bank's pay framework, clearly the bank's board is ultimately responsible for the assessment criteria, appraisal and payments made under the bank's pay framework. It operates within our public sector pay policy with exceptions and adaptations as approved by ministers in June last year. The framework has got to reflect the fact that the bank operates in the financial services sector, but it's also a public body, and it is modelled to align with the approaches taken in other UK development banks. There'll be no annual financial target-based bonuses within the bank. The chief executive and other staff instead are going to have access to long-term incentive schemes linked to the delivery of missions and objective-based targets. And that ensures that an element of pay is linked to the bank achieving its public service mission without the creation of a bonus culture. And that remains my position, certainly.
Okay, thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. I'd like to thank the Cabinet Secretary and the officials for attending this morning. And we hope to see the Cabinet Secretary back in Parliament soon. But we'll now take our five-minute break for the next panel. This is a UK government bill introduced in the House of Lords on the 12th of May, which changes the law on devolved matters. So I'd like to welcome Ivan McKee, Minister for Business, Trade, Tourism and Enterprise, who's joined by David McClelland, who's solicitor, and Richard Shearer, Head of Services, Trade Policy, both the Scottish Government. I'd like to invite the Minister to make a brief statement on the Scottish Government's position, then we'll move to questions.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning, Committee. It's great to be here. So I'd like to thank the Committee for inviting me to discuss this important legislative consent issue today. The principle of the recognition of professional qualifications is to allow suitably qualified people the chance to work in or trade with other countries. For Scotland, this means getting access to doctors, vets, nurses and engineers with skills gained in other countries that we need here, but also enables our professionals to take up skill-enhancing opportunities abroad or to export their services to other countries. To put this in context, doctors, nurses and vets qualified in another country rely on MRPQ to be able to work here. And the latest data shows that international exports of professional scientific and technical activities were worth £3.4 billion in 2018, 20% of total services and 10% of total international exports. Within the EU, there is a formal system for the recognition of qualifications that was lost when the UK left the EU. As a responsible government, the Scottish Government has worked with the UK Government and Scottish Parliament to amend legislation on MRPQ that was brought into UK law as a result of Brexit. This bill covers a number of important issues for regulators now the UK is no longer in the EU. It seeks to provide all professional regulators with the power to enter into agreements with counterparts abroad, as some do not have that power. There are also powers for UK and devolved ministers to make regulations covering professions over which they can legislate. We know that a variety of UK-wide and devolved regulators have expressed concerns about the terms of the bill as relates to professional standards, and there is a risk that UK ministers might trade away existing high standards to secure free trade agreements. I understand that BEIS have continued to engage with regulators across the UK, and I hope they will seek to allay those fears through amendments to the bill. The committee will know that Scottish ministers felt they could not recommend granting consent for this bill as it stands. The bill, as drafted, confers concurrent powers in devolved areas to both UK and Scottish ministers, but without a requirement to seek consent before doing so. In addition, UK ministers could amend or disapply regulations that were legitimately made here and supported by this Parliament. The issues around consent are relevant to a number of other UK government bills, and I would hope the UK government would take proper account of our legitimate concerns in this area. Scottish ministers have asked UK ministers to amend the bill to include a requirement for consent before acting in devolved areas. As we were told, UK ministers do not intend to act without agreement, then there is no problem that I can see to amending the bill. And I am keen to work with BEIS constructively for as long as Scotland is part of the UK, where we have shared interests, and this includes this bill on MRPQ. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. And I should also say that you're the first we have had in front of us to the committee, so we welcome you joining us here this morning, the first witness. Can I ask, you have outlined the reasons why the government are not prepared to put forward a memorandum of consent at the moment. If an amendment was to be accepted and that issue was to be resolved, are you satisfied with the proposals that are in the bill? Would you think it would resolve the issues we have of recognising qualifications?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, there are, from our perspective, that's clearly the main issue, the impingement on devolved responsibilities. Clearly, there are issues that have been raised by regulators that have concerns as well. But the main issue for us is round about the devolved aspects of that. We recognise the asks from the regulators. We're supportive of many of those, and we're hopeful that the UK government on those as well would move forward with appropriate amendments.
Okay, thank you. Again, Maggie Chapman, I think could you come?
Thanks very much, Convener, and thank you, Minister, for outlining that the government's position just now. You mentioned engagement with regulators just there, but can I ask, are you aware of any other concerns that either they or other stakeholders in Scotland have had about the provisions in this bill?
Well, their concerns are largely, as I understand it, and they'll speak for themselves, round about the potential downgrading of standards in pursuit of international trade deals. Clearly that is something to be concerned about, and them not the UK government being in a position to make changes there that the regulators weren't comfortable with.
Okay. Thanks.
Jamie Halker-Johnson.
Thanks very much. Good morning, Minister. Can I just ask, I suppose, firstly, what ongoing consultation or discussions there are with the UK government, either at ministerial or official level?
There's ongoing engagement at official level on a regular basis on this, and it's an issue I've spoken with Jerry Grimstone, the relevant UK government minister, on as well, and written to him on this. So it's an area where we're hopeful that there will be movement, and there is ongoing discussion on this, as on many, many other areas, on a regular basis.
So you think you're quite positive about the potential to get an amendment to this?
I would like to think so, but I think it will really come down to UK government reflecting on the situation we're in. Clearly, there have been other bills in this regard where the UK government has sought to impinge on devolved matters that haven't concluded the way we'd like them to. But in this case, I would be hopeful that they would recognise the importance of not impinging on devolved areas and amend the bill accordingly.
And in terms of the stakeholders that you mentioned earlier, how are you keeping? Are you kind of keeping them in touch with those discussions, or are you relying on them having discussions with the UK government in terms of potential amendments?
They'll be having a discussion separately, but we will be. Officials are engaging with those regulators on an ongoing basis as well to understand their concerns, both with regards to the professional issues I mentioned and with regards to how this impinges on devolved matters.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you. The Minister has indicated where he would like the UK Government to make amendments. You might be aware the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee did argue that there should be introduced a statutory requirement to consult with affected regulators in relation to international treaties. Is that something that the Government would support and be asking the UK Government to look at?
Yes, I mean, our ask is that the requirement to seek consent is placed on the face of the bill in devolved matters, and with regards to the broader issue of international trade, there's an ongoing discussion with UK government on that over a lengthy period now, and we published now 2 years ago, I think, our perspective on how Scotland should be involved and other devolved administrations, our government and the parliament should be involved and all aspects and all stages of pulling together international trade agreements. So that's a long-standing position that we've had in that regard, and equally applies with regards to professional qualifications.
Thank you. Colin Beattie.
Yeah, Minister, just a quick question. How does the Scottish Government envisage that the provisions of the bill would interplay with the relevant provisions in the Internal Market Act?
Well, clearly the Internal Market Act gives the UK government the ability to impinge on devolved areas, which is something we're deeply unhappy about. So, as we know, per devolved is per retained, so the UK government effectively can do as it wishes in that regard. The Internal Market Bill allows it to do that, but that doesn't mean it's a wise thing to do or something that's in the interest of Scotland for it to do so.
Thank you. Michelle Thompson.
Just following on from that point, have you had any indications that you could share for any possible or reasonable rationale as to why the UK government wouldn't accept the amendment given your stated concerns about standards? Is there anything you could share? I mean, if they're saying that we have no intention of doing that, well, why not simply accept the amendment? Is there anything more you can offer around that?
Your analysis is correct. Our position is that if the UK government has no desire to impinge on those areas, then they should make that clear by stating on the face of the bill. And it's difficult to see why they wouldn't do that. But as I say, we continue those discussions and hope that their position will be changed to reflect that very logical position as you've outlined it there.
Just very briefly, the Health and Social Care Committee of this Parliament has got concerns, and obviously there are live issues about recruitment and skill and labour shortages, particularly in health and social care. Is this something, therefore, that is not just, I suppose, dry and academic, but very real in terms of the recruitment capability of the Scottish Government to recruit and retain highly skilled workers, but also at the highest standard of the Scottish regulator.
Yes, I think, and that's an important point. It does not, on the surface of it, MRPQ does not sound like the most exciting of subjects, but in reality, as I've indicated on so many levels, in terms of the proportion of our trade it represents, and that's an increasing proportion, the ability of Scottish professionals to work internationally, which is hugely important for their aspirations and career development and business, of course. And as you've rightly said, the requirements for movement of professionally trained individuals to support, be it our health and social care sector or a whole range of other sectors that might apply to it, directly impinges on our ability to be able to respond to situations. And as a devolved government, clearly the responsibility for doing so, it's important that those powers remain within that devolved remit.
Thank you. Can I just finally ask, the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee also talked about Clause 3 of the bill and compelling devolved regulators to charge fees. I mean, the approach would tend to be that you try to reduce barriers to people coming to work and support our economy and our public services. Do you have concerns? Have you had any discussions with devolved regulators about the proposal to charge fees? And could you explain, does the fee section include what level the fee would be set at, or would we have flexibility in the
thanks for the question. I'm not aware on the specifics of fee levels, and I think I might defer to one of the officials who may have more on the detail on that and any conversations I've had on the specifics of that with the devolved regulators.
Okay, thank you.
I don't know who's best to come in on that.
Richard Shearer, would you like to come in?
Yes, thank you. Our understanding of the fee section is that it's not clear as to whether or not there'd be any interaction with regulators in determining the charging of fees, but there are some regulators who've noted the fact that some of the changes that might be introduced from this bill might introduce costs that they don't currently have, and how they would offset those costs. But the imposition either of a fixed fee or the removal of the ability to charge fees would be something that could be potentially concerning. And we would expect in the first instance that regulators should be able to make autonomous decisions about fee charging, but they should be reasonable and reflect the service that's being provided.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, and I'll just follow up on that. Say you're right, convener. Obviously, we are everything else being equal, keen to remove those barriers to trade where they exist.
Thank you, Minister, and thank you to the Minister and the officials for attending this morning. That brings this evidence session to a close. That concludes the public part of the meeting, and we'll now move into private session.